Hey guys, so this past Sunday I went to church with my dad. Shouldn't be too surprised, this is a regular thing once I come down to my parents' neighborhood and my home. My dad is a pastor after all, so we do a lot of church things. If I'm here, I go to church every Sunday. I would normally go to my dad's church and he would be preaching and doing all that worship service and whatnot, but there has been a interesting family circumstances that occur, so we're kind of going to different churches now. Anyway, this past Sunday, I went to this American church because my dad's Korean. He's a Korean pastor. He usually does Korean service. He doesn't really know English all that well. It's a language issue, not really a nationality issue or anything. We went to a local American Assembly of God church. That's my dad's denomination, Assembly of God, or Full Gospel is the nickname of the denomination. And we went. So there's a funny thing I want to talk about that, but we ended up going because it really is my first time going to a local American church in Tennessee. I've never been to an American church in Tennessee. I've been to many other ones in different states and different parts of the country. So we ended up going because just recently, 2 weeks ago, my parents and I took a trip to Louisiana, and on Wednesday, my mom wanted to go to a church, didn't do service on Wednesday night because my mom is extremely, really devout and religious. So we went to a church in Louisiana. It was a First Assembly of God church in New Orleans. And I kind of made an offhanded comment to my dad. It's like, wow, this church is really big. Not a lot of people, but the size of it. There were a lot of chairs. They had a stage. It was a big church. So I was like, this is a really big church. This is bigger than any of the churches I've been inside Tennessee. And my dad's like, wait, you've never went to the American Assembly of God Church in Tennessee, have you? I was like, I don't think so. And he's like, I need to take you there. It's much bigger than this church in Louisiana. So that's kind of what had us going. I mean, I think he kind of always wanted to take me there and show to me what it was like. And the size, it's kind of similar to the one I went to Louisiana. The comparison that we really wanted to make was, you know, we used to live in Bakersfield, California for a long time, for over 10 years. And in those churches, my dad he started a church there. He had a ministry in one of the churches in Bakersfield First Assembly of God Church. There he had borrowed a cafeteria and he did a Korean church there. In California, our church was called Living Hope Community Church. That's the name of the church, but the denomination is Assembly of God. And that church is gigantic. Bakersfield First Assembly of God Church is gigantic. So I was asking my dad, I said, okay, if it's bigger than this Louisiana church, then is it bigger than Bakersfield First Assembly of God? And he was like, eh. And the minute he did that, I was like, oh, if you're doing that, then it really must be a pretty damn big church. And he's like, nah, I think it's bigger. But then I reminded him, you know, Dad, is it really? Because Bakersfield First Assembly of God, the worship place, it's two stories. They had a second, you know, I was like, oh, right. No, it's not bigger than Bakersfield First Assembly of God. And I was like, yeah, I thought so, because that's a huge church. Anyway, that's the kind of conversation that resulted in me going to the local church here. That's all about the size. But this Sunday, when we went, the pastor who preached, who gave a sermon, wasn't the local pastor, but it was a visiting guest. I don't know what exactly his title is, but he works on behalf of Life for the Lost Ministry. I think that's the name of the organization. It's a nonprofit religious organization that started in the 1950s, and the aim of this organization is to fundraise to buy resources and materials. Resources meaning Bibles mostly, but a bunch of other things. To buy resources and to provide them to, you know, evangelical missionary groups, all the way out to Latin America and Africa, China and such. That's the aim of the organization. One of the important people, Tom Green was his name, was there. He gave a sermon, and that whole service was kind of odd. Well, before I get into that, first thing that kind of struck me as odd was, you know, before any preaching begins in a church service normally. I don't know if that's true for all the churches, but at least with Assembly of God churches and with Baptist churches, because I've been to Baptist Presbyterian churches, I've been to Presbyterian services as well. There's so many churches and so many services that I've been to, being a pastor's son and all. But yeah, we usually start with songs and hymns and praise songs and such. And me being a pastor's son and having been to all these churches and actually having led praise teams in certain churches myself, I know a damn lot of praise songs and hymns. But this service, they were singing songs I had never heard of. I wasn't aware of any of these songs. I was like, I don't know how to, this is the first time I'm hearing this song. So my dad was telling me, like, yeah, this church, the worship leader is the daughter of the pastor here. And she always liked to find brand new songs from the Christian community. And so back in the days, that wouldn't have mattered because I would have known, because I was really into the Christian scene, whatever. All the new songs or new hymns that would be, I would know anyway. But it just kind of reminded me, like, wow, yeah, I haven't been a Christian for a long time to not be aware of any of these songs. I've been out of the Christian scene for quite a while now. That just kind of reminded me of that. Anyway, the sermons. Sermons to this service, I don't know, for a particular reason, it's been a long time since I've actually been to an American service. I mean, I've been to the one in Louisiana service. The general comment I want to make is that there are a few churches that I've been to down here in the South, in the Bible Belt states, mind you, you know, Tennessee, Georgia, Florida, now Louisiana, these Southern states. What I like about these churches, the pastors, they really know their congregations, like, really well. Like, this church in Tennessee, the pastor was naming people that are regular members of the congregation and kind of giving well wishes and updating them on their situations. It was amazing. Like, the other churches that I've been to in other states, namely California and New York, you know, they're so big churches that, like, they're not this deeply personally connected to their congregation, the pastors, I mean. But all the Southern churches I've been to, they have that. So I think that's really awesome with those pastors. But one thing I'll say about Southern churches, and I'm probably not accurate because there's too many churches and I've only been to quite a number of them, but if I was to make a biased judgment based on those few number of churches that I've been to, their sermons are rubbish. Like, these pastors, like, I don't know. I don't want to make a judgment because I you know, again, but the sermons that I've heard from them, the way they preach, it's just low quality. these Southern churches. That's how I feel. I don't know. I'm being really arrogant and condescending here. But I've listened to and watched a lot of sermons in my lifetime, especially from my dad, especially from my dad's pastor, friend pastors, and from my friend's pastors. There was a girl I knew back in high school. Her dad was a pastor, and I went to her church frequently. You know, compared to all the sermons that I've received, listened to in Southern churches, not that great. This time, this guest speaker, I guess he's been around the country a lot, so he's a really great speaker. But the content was kind of, this whole church service this Sunday, it just felt like a fundraiser event. It was kind of like I was being canvassed to, and I've been a canvasser, you know, I was out in the streets asking people for money for a non-profit organization. That's kind of what it felt like, being canvassed to. It makes sense. Churches are businesses too. They need the Benjamins, like everybody else. It's just kind of weird because, you know, growing up in a Christian background, whatever, one never gets to thinking, you know, it's an obvious thing that churches need money too, and they're there to get money, and they really, the only way churches really get money is to get it out of offerings and tithes out of people. But this whole service was like that. It was just to get people's money. Before the sermon, there was a message about offering and giving the resources necessary for the Life for the Lost ministry so they could provide resources to missionary groups and providing resources and offerings to God to be able to have this church maintain itself and to grow. It was like I was at a business session and no one but I knew it. Everybody else was just... The thing that bothers me the most, you know, churches need money like every other business out there. The thing that bothers me the most when churches do it is they guilt you so badly. Not even car salesmen, even, I don't know, maybe some organizations do it, like Canvassing for Children's International. That group is ridiculous with this canvassing methods. Really awful way to canvass. If you ever become like a fundraiser, whatever, stay away from Children's International. They're the ones that really guilt you into giving. And they use the most bizarre methods to get people to give to them. These churches are kind of like that because they guilt you with something eternal, something that you can't ever attain until after you die, right? For example, one of the things that this guy said in the sermon was, you know, you don't want to, you know, stand before God and you know, and have to admit to God, you know, I could have given to the poor, I could have given more, but I just wasn't able to, God. You don't want to have excuses before God when you stand before God on the day of judgment. That's kind of the thing that the pastor says. Really, that's guilting you into giving money to the organization. Another thing that really irked me, really, really irked me, was, you know, he kind of mentioned this tithe thing, you know. Tithe is a given thing, gives you blessing, you know, you give 10% of all, whatever. He gave a really good sob story, too, to kind of connect into the message of tithing. And he said, tithing is what you do for your church, for our organization, for you supporting us. We don't ask for your tithe, you know, we ask for your generous giving in addition to your tithe. Your tithe should go to your church, but the extra giving should be for the... Yeah, really irksome, because tithe is a given. It's kind of like this revenue stream is just expected. Everyone is just supposed to give a tithe. And, you know, I have to say, when churches get their funds, for the most part, except when it's like these huge, gigantic televangelist churches... you know, some atheists would say, you know, churches are scammers, it's a gigantic pyramid scheme, whatever. I don't have that opinion, because at least churches are honest, usually, with their money. Lost for the Light Ministry, whatever. You know, they say they're going to buy Bibles to send to China. It's what they usually do. But you know, they lay out, usually the churches I've been to, and I know my dad's church. I got to see the operation from the inside, from deep inside. So, you know, churches that I've been to are pretty transparent with how they spend their money. So, don't really have a huge problem with that. I mean, there is a problem in this country that, you know, with taxes and politics of church separation between church and state, but I'm not going to touch that right now. But the problem really is, like, it's the guilting, it's... Sometimes the money goes and, you know, another thing that irked me before the sermon, they had a prayer, and even the prayer was about giving to the church and to the ministry. There was a separate fund, there was a separate offering collected for the travel fare of the guest speaker, you know, and the local pastor was like, you know, hotels aren't free, car fare, you know, this thankful young man, we're grateful that he's come here, and, you know, he wanted to save money, so he didn't buy a plane ticket, but he came to Missouri, Springfield, Missouri, with the car. He drove us here, but gas, you know, isn't free, so this church service, they even collected money for travel fare and hotel fare of the guest speaker. I was kind of like, I was sitting there, I was dumbfounded and surrounded by people going, amen, hallelujah. Man, if there's any business that could, like, guilt people into giving money and getting money from people, I mean, it's churches. It's really churches. I'm sure, I mean, they're doing God's work, they're evangelizing, but it's really, and you know, my dad being a pastor and all, you know, it's pastors need money to be able to keep pastoring. One thing that really struck home to me, and this is now a different side story altogether, I think I'm totally done with the story of the church I visited last Sunday. There's a lot of politics within the churches and whatnot, and sometimes there is a political fight between the pastor and the leaders, or the people with positions within the church. You know, they have their positions like the person who takes care of the church's finances, pastor secretary, and all that. Those are kind of jobs, except unlike normal businesses, you can't just fire people for being incompetent in churches. I don't know, maybe some churches do, but that's a big problem in churches. And so there is always this political struggle between the elders or the deacons of the church and the pastor. My dad's friend pastor recently had to resign because the conflict between the pastor and the deacons got so bad that the deacons organized the whole church into not giving an offering. In other words, pastor's not getting paid. That's how it had happened. It just always like that kind of just struck me as like, wow, that can happen where the church members can organize themselves into not tithing, not offering. And what does that do? That means there's no salary for the pastor. And the pastor, unless he's got a wife who has a second job, fact is, most pastors' wives don't have jobs of their own. They really depend on the pastor's salary. And some churches provide housing and transportation and all that for their pastors. So once the congregation cuts those, the pastor is done. He's got to move town or he's got to do something, but he's done. There's no way for him to sustain his lifestyle, his living, because the church is no longer paying him salary. I was just like, wow, that's crazy. That's something I've never even thought of before. You know, it's a simple, obvious thought, but the end conclusion is churches are like businesses like any other businesses. And it's kind of weird to consider that, but it's just how it is sometimes. I think a lot of Christians are blind to that kind of thing, don't want to think about it. And it's not even just Christians, you know, churches, temples, synagogues, mosques, they all run on money. Everything runs on money. And it's just something to think about, you know, everything runs on money. And how this money sustaining fundraising thing occurs in the name of God, in the name of Christ, in the name of propagating the message of truth. You know, it's an interesting thing to see unfold, how it works. It's just really kind of interesting. Although it's to me, I would like to imagine a society where this just, well, you know, I mean, it does provide jobs, this industry of religion. Pastors make money, but I don't know. Sometimes I wish, and this wish would probably never be realized, but sometimes I wish my dad would just quit ministry altogether, do something completely else, or just retire and just you know, have my mom be the primary breadwinner as a nurse. I don't know. But yeah, those are my just random thoughts out there of me having visited a church and having these thoughts. Tell me guys what you think, if anything, any comments, whatever, that'll be fine. Cool. Hope you guys enjoyed. Cheers.